Now, in the beginning, President Marcos Jr. actually, when he intervened in, sources tell me, a heated discussion between Speaker Martin Romualdez and Senate President Zubiri, he had already tasked the Senate to take the lead when it comes to the economic amendments, right, via constituent assembly. Would you be in favor of a constituent assembly for changes?
Well, if the purpose is to amend the nationalistic provisions of the Constitution, which are designed to protect and preserve Philippine patrimony, then I am objecting to that, as I have objected to that enterprise a long time ago. Because we should not blame the economic provisions in the Constitution for the present crisis in our country. According to the OECD, that's the Organization on Economic Cooperation and Development, the amendment of a country's constitution is not a prerequisite to the entry of foreign direct investment. The following are the proper inducements. One, there should be an ease of doing business instead of a bureaucratic dilatory process. Number two, the investor should be given that feeling of stability and predictability of government policies. Mm-hmm. Number three, there should be an elimination or at least a reduction of official corruption. Number four, there should be infrastructure support for investors. Number five, there should be faster internet speed. And lastly, lower cost of power or electricity. These are the factors which will induce, which will encourage the entry of foreign direct investment. Not tampering with the Constitution. The Constitution is blameless for our crisis in the economy, in agriculture, in food security, as well as in education, health, employment, the ballooning debt service, the ballooning deficit in our budget deficit, and the continuing aggression on China and the West Philippine Sea. These are the things Congress and the president should turn their attention to.
Mm-hmm. All right. So essentially what you're saying is there's so many other areas to prioritize on first, right? Fix these areas first and don't make changing the Constitution the first recourse to actually improving investments in the Philippines. Moving from that, you're now hearing the president say he wants to find another mode. I mean, because it's turned into politicking. So he's now consulting with legal luminaries on how best to proceed with charter change. What are your thoughts on that? Because clearly the president wants it. He wants these changes.
Well, the president anchors his agenda on charter change with respect to the economic provisions, which I said already, it is not necessary. Mm-hmm. It is not timely.
If the president insists on this, what could happen?
Well, if the president would insist and the supermajority in the House as well as in the Senate would agree, quote-unquote, to the president's position, then I think a constituent assembly will be called. Mm. And the voting there would be separate instead of joint, as initiated in the People's Initiative to make it joint voting in the constituent assembly. This would marginalize the senators. Because of the
for sure the senators would not allow a joint voting. That's for sure, because we've already seen, right, how the senators have unanimously stood together against the people's initiative after discovering that there was a voting jointly motivation in the people's initiative. So clearly the Senate will stand as a whole on this. But in terms of calling for a constituent assembly, is it clear at this point how that can happen? Well, are you trying to say if the president calls for that, that's the only solution? Because then isn't the legislature a separate institution?
Well, I think the president cannot call for the constituent assembly. It has to be called by the Congress. By both houses. But there is a prejudicial question here. Mm. Because the Constitution does not state categorically whether the voting will be joint or separate.
Yes.
This is a question which should be brought in a proper case before the Supreme Court to decide. Because otherwise...
Wouldn't that be too premature? I mean, the Supreme Court won't decide on a hypothetical situation.
That's why I said in a proper case. In the proper case is once there is already a call.
Yeah.
The Constituent Assembly. Mm-mm. Because we leave it to the House or to the Senate, there will be an impasse because they are coming both from partisan and ulterior motives. Mm-hmm. On the part of the House, it wants to outnumber the Senate in the voting. On the part of the Senate, it rejects this kind of procedure because they will be outvoted. In fact, if this happens on joint voting, the Senate can even be proposed to be abolished by a constituent assembly.
Mm.
These are partisan motives from both sides. Let a third party resolve the issue, and that is the Supreme Court.
All right. You've already said that the People's Initiative as of today is frankly dead in the water. It's dead on arrival in the lower house now.
It's dead on arrival in the COMELEC, the petition.
In the COMELEC. Okay. It's dead in the water, dead on arrival in the COMELEC. So what's the point? And it's the insistence of a People's Initiative has already come to the point where you have now the UNITIM breaking down with the Dutertes aligned together, right, against the president. Mm-hmm. What is this costing President Marcos Jr.? I think the issue for the ordinary citizen, like myself, is kauumpisa pa lang nag-aaway na. Hindi pa nga nararamdaman yung pagbuti ng buhay namin. Eto, nagbabangayan na sila kaagad. This is just 2 years into his term.
Well, I have called on the president more than 2 weeks ago to broker and resolve the impasse between the Senate and the House. I think the president has the power and the mandate to do that, so that the political departments of the government, which is the executive and the legislative, can focus on the pressing issues and do not sacrifice the interests and welfare of the people in a useless enterprise. Amending the Constitution is not necessary. It is not timely. I have said that Chacha is out of step now.
Now, I've interviewed senators who have called on President Marcos Jr. to rein in on the speaker. Those were their words, not mine. Rein in on your cousin. Tell him, stop this foolishness. Ang tanong ko, why can't he and why isn't he?
Well, I think the president is realizing that this impasse is causing the government from putting attention to the real problems, and it is also causing him a political quote unquote setback. Mm-hmm. And I believe he's still talking, and he has was probably initiated already that conversation between Speaker Romualdez and himself, and mm-hmm. also with the leadership of the Senate, because it takes two to tango, and the problem is the House and the Senate are coming from the same, if not different, perspective, which is ulterior motive and partisan enterprise.
And where will this lead? Now you have, as Ronald Llamas, no, a political analyst, said yesterday, never has he seen a former president attack a sitting president in the manner that former President Duterte did. Is this a threat? Are you seeing this as a threat to the Marcos presidency?
Well, it is a manifestation of a possible agenda on this destabilization to be conducted by the former president. You know, Karen, a former president has always a reserved support. And this is why the incumbent president, President Bongbong Marcos, is not really so keen on igniting a conflict with the former president at the moment. Mm-hmm. But we cannot possibly rein in circumstances. For example, I think the ICC, the International Criminal Court, has already finished this prosecutor's investigation.
Yeah.
And sooner will come out with a decision and possibly cause the arrest of the former president and his cohorts. Now, that would be a very difficult situation on the part of the president. But I think, ultimately, the country will have to abide by the decision of the ICC. We should not be a rebel in the community of nations. And that would further inflame the division between the Marcos and the Duterte forces. And that started some time ago. But I think the disenchantment, the disengagement came sooner than expected.
Yeah, you've said that the disenchantment came sooner than expected. If you were to say something to President Marcos Jr. right now, what would it be? I mean, he just came from Vietnam. You know, he's been traveling all over the world trying to sell the country to foreign investors.
Well, I think he is the incumbent president. He has supposed to have an electoral mandate, then he should exercise the powers and prerogatives of a sitting president.
On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me today. Albay First District Representative Edsel Lagman. Thank you, sir.
Karen, before we end, I would like to say that the Constitution is a living instrument. It is not a relic of the past. The Constitution gives guidelines to the present and guideposts for the future. So it should not be amended at whip or whim. It should be stable. It should not be blamed for failures of the administrators to fully implement the wiser and more important policies in governance. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you very much, sir.